Let's take a moment to pause and listen. Let's start with listening to Shantideva. What do you think? I couldn't think of anything else. I've been thinking about what he things to say. Nothing came up except something from Shantideva. What needed there to say more? The childish work for their own benefit. The Buddhas, awakened ones, work for the benefit of others. Just look at the difference between them. If I do not exchange my happiness for the suffering of others, I shall not attain the state of Buddhahood. And even in samsara, I shall have no real joy. Forget about awakening. Even here, I'm not going to have happiness. The source of all misery in the world lies in thinking of oneself. All the suffering there is in this world arises from wishing ourself to be happy. Is that your experience? The source of all happiness lies in thinking of others. All the happiness there is in this world arises from wishing others to be happy. Therefore, one should do nothing other than what is directly or indirectly of benefit to living beings. There is nothing to harm you, nothing to fear other than my mind. So take a few moments to soak in this wisdom, truth of wisdom, not through intellectual thinking mind. See if we can feel from the guts. See if we can have an embodied experience of this real logic, which we are missing the point. But here at the New Year gathering, it's auspicious, and this is the time to really come back to real truth and real motivation, and also feel into this responsibility, spiritual responsibility, as well as responsibility as a human citizen in the globe, universe, galaxy. Where would I find enough leather to cover the entire surface of the earth, right? But with leather soles, if we put on the leather shoes, with leather soles beneath my feet, it's as if the whole world has been covered. In other words, it is not possible to control all external events. But if I simply control my mind, what's need is there to control other things. And also, we are so worried about this and that, fear. If the problem can be solved, why worry? If the problem cannot be solved, worrying will do you no good. See if we can relax a little bit. Relax the anxiety, unnecessarily worry, then take responsibility for our own action and our own mind. Then he said, so take advantage of this human boat. Our body, human precious life is like a boat, ship. Free yourself from sorrow's mighty stream. This vessel will be later harder to find. The time that you have now, you fool, is not for sleep. He's pointing out we are like sleepwalking. He's asking us to wake up. Don't miss this opportunity. So today we are here gathering for this auspicious new year, beginning of 2023. So I'm so happy to see all of you. You are able to show up and present, and somehow your deepest wish, aspiration brought you here. I would like to show you something. Is that okay? Today is not like a teaching session or nothing like that, right? More like a Rumi said, remembering. So this is the time for reminding ourselves and remembering what's important, what makes us happy, what makes all people, all beings, living being happy. See, over the course of the days, we are caught by trivials, then we forget. So reminder, we need a lot of reminders, like Shantideva. So here today, we are together for reminding ourselves and reminding each other. And also, I want you to allow your heart to be moved by this sublime, most profound, deepest, complete, I can put lots of adjectives, but complete openness of your heart, which is residing the core of who and what you are. Maybe we're gonna stop. You got the idea, His Holiness, the wisdom. Those are words coming from somebody who awakened into bodhicitta. Bodhicitta is innate. At the same time, we need to unveil and cultivate. So there are main teachings, Mahayana teachings. We train ourselves how to cultivate the bodhicitta. But on a daily basis, I think we've been practicing. We try to act based on bodhicitta motivation as much as possible in our level. That's how we get started, no? All right, just for a few moments after this, His Holiness' teaching, and also Shantideva's teaching quote. See if we can connect your relationship to bodhicitta. Yeah, so I just want to open up some kind of free sharing session. As I've been saying, this is not a teaching, and I have nothing to share in terms of bodhicitta. And I've been kind of trying my meager attempt to really emphasize the importance of bodhicitta, whatever we do. Now you heard from His Holiness, so you know what I've been saying is not something pop up in my mind temporarily. That's something not only spiritual practice. Of course, spiritual practice, just that's the point, no? Have to, based on this bodhicitta. Relative bodhicitta, ultimate bodhicitta, those things are taught, and what entails, all those are the core essence of practice. Those two things, you can say wisdom and method, wisdom of emptiness and compassion, great compassion. So not only on a spiritual journey, but also our day-to-day basis, human journeys. If we have this complete openness of our heart, that makes our happy, makes our neighbors happy, makes everything, cats happy, animals. Yeah, talking about animal, this was Rabbit on the Moon. Is that the title? In Japan, we use the Western kind of calendars. So New Year is New Year, January 1st. Then each year we use the Chinese, it's already adapted in Japan. So we're using this 12 cycle of the animals, zodiac, that's called. So in this year is a rabbit, year of rabbit. I don't know about you, but whenever I hear about the rabbit, then remember moon. And the story about the rabbit on the moon, which I grown up with, symbolizing this selfless act. So really come back to my own actions, my deepest motivations, more like where my action coming from. So that's part I would like to talk about, discuss, remind myself actually by listening to how you are living your life, so to speak. Yeah, bodhicitta is boundless. So we don't say, okay, I finished, you know, so grow more and more, right? Yeah. Which is a joy, actually. It's something really very special.
Well, first I was just going to ask, will you tell the story of the rabbit on the moon?
Rabbit on the moon? My lullaby version, bedtime stories. Okay, anybody else know? You wanted me to tell. Okay, I will do my best. It's actually Jataka tale. You know Jataka tale is that story, collection of the story, Buddha's previous life stories. Buddha was born as a rabbit, donkey, elephant, bird, and monkeys, and all these kind of animals. Then he did a bodhisattva act, so zillions of aeons. He practiced as a bodhisattva. That's exactly what we are discussing, this bodhicitta. Once bodhicitta arose in his mind, in his heart, when he was born in the hell realm. Anyway, since then, he worked so hard. He went to all different realms, right? Anyway, once upon a time, he was born as a rabbit. Indian story, right, originated in India. So the Indian god disguised in a beggar. He tried to test. A lot of our stories don't say all those details. Said the beggar showed up. He was starving to death. What you would do? All different animals had a means to bring food, right? You know, lions bring different animals. Then rabbit thought, I have nothing to give because rabbit eat grass, right? And that doesn't satisfy the beggar's stomach. So he was thinking. Then he light bulbs pops up. Okay, let's make a fire. Then he made a fire, he asked the beggar to make fire. Then you know what he did? He jumped into the fire. That's the kind of moment of my crying, you know, rabbit, they're gonna die. At that moment, this beggar turned into this awakened one, or the god. And then you are such a selfless, your selfless act should be honored. Then the rabbit went to the moon, or somehow magically he put the rabbit to the moon. Maybe he lifted all the way to the moon. Then he said, this will be a reminder for all beings in the future. This your selfless act is the most sublime act of all. Something like that. So when we look at the moon as a child, rabbit there, and then the pounding the rice, you know, the mochis pounding. So it's mixture of Jataka tale and also localized a little bit, you know, folklore or something, local kind of flavors. So that's just one story, one of many stories of Jataka, what the Buddha did. In other words, Buddha practiced bodhicitta through two practice, sacrificing, self-sacrificing, sacrificing oneself for the benefit of others. Then my question, or our question in this modern world, what does that mean to each of us? Then emphasis of bodhicitta, of course, two practice as well. It's not about really hurting oneself physically, but in terms of motivation and the mind, exchanging the self for others and changing or transforming a mind. So that's the key, no? So that's the story. And also monkeys' stories. Of course, you know the tigress, hungry tigress one, right? Actually, historically, there's a site, Namo Buddha in Nepal. The Buddha offered his body to hungry tigress. This tiger mom was so hungry, starving. Then she was about to eat her cubs. Then this prince saw this misery or the dilemma of samsara, like eating one's own child. Then he jumped into tiger's mouth and ate me instead. So that's what Buddha did. And also once he was born as an elephant. Again, purposely he fall from the cliff, fall off and die. So he became food for other beings. And the monkey king, he was born as a monkey king and stretching one's own body and create a bridge to help assist all the other beings. Something like that. Sounds like a just bedtime story and a good moral. What's the moral to try to discipline ourselves? But at this time on our journey, what's that mean to each of us? It's nice. It's worthwhile to think about. Not to think about though. But then we are already on the journey. So we do our best to practice bodhicitta deeper and deeper. Grow more and more.
But actually, a number of years ago, I got a fortune and a fortune cookie that said the greatest accomplishment is selflessness. And I put it on my refrigerator. And it's with a little magnet. It's been on my refrigerator for years. And it's interesting to see the reaction from people coming through the house, from the grandkids to, you know, our children and some people, you know, puzzled. It's like, what? You know, it seems so extreme in this day and age in our Western culture, this idea of complete selflessness to me. And yet, just listening to the Dalai Lama, listening to you, listening to Shanti Deva, it's so true. You know, it's true. And yet it's still kind of hard to do. So I'm inspired to pay more attention to my fortune on my refrigerator and explore, I think really for me to bring it to this one word, selflessness. Understanding that that is rises from some glimpse of emptiness, some understanding of emptiness. I think Chogyam Trungpa called compassion without that idiot compassion, I think, or something like that.
So, yeah, so you said it's so true. So at that moment, you had some kind of glimpse. I said, it's so true. That's very precious, no? That glimpse. So then, of course, that's the practice, no? That's not to stay there, glimpse, but then collection of the glimpse become more embodied. Then that glimpse doesn't come, or the idea or the understanding doesn't come from intellectual, more like embodied experience from the guts, I said. Then all the actions become natural. Right now, I don't know about you, but we are trying very effortful practice right now. I'm sure you can relate to that. But eventually, action coming from this deepest one is very natural. Altruistic action. Fortunately, we have a model like His Holiness Dalai Lama. His action doesn't come naturally from the beginning. He practiced every day. He made an effort on the top of his previous whatever karmic imprint he carried. But that's not enough. No, he had to make effort. He had to share like that. And then cultivate more and more. Interesting thing about emptiness is the bodhicitta assist the realization of emptiness. The emptiness assists the realization of bodhicitta. we have to go together, both, not contradictory. It's complementary. So, I'm very excited about this new Ramlin group. It's the basis of this Bodhicitta. We have this idea, right? Bodhicitta is very sublime, and I want to have. That's it. You know? But then the Bodhicitta is almost like outcome of all these hard work, but the step-by-step process. First, equanimity. We have to have this equality. You know, enemy, friend, your neighbor, and your children or whoever. You know, all these have equanimity. In order to have that, we need to cultivate step by step, something like that. So Ramlin, I encourage everybody to join if you want to cultivate the bodhicitta and grow more and more. When I was citing about Shantideva, he said directly and indirectly. He added both directly and indirectly, helping others. It's very important to help directly and if possible, whatever way we can. But if we cannot, that doesn't mean we cannot help others, right? So in the West, sometimes in the helping professions, they directly help and then burn out. I don't know. So need to cultivate this deepest our own heart, where that's coming from. So indirectly helping others is also very important, actually key, this cultivation of bodhicitta as a spiritual practitioner.
So I asked her if she had any advice for us before we got married. And she said, give the other person victory. How hard a practice that is for me.
It's difficult, isn't it? But once we are able to do that, do you have that moment when you have a chance to get the win or the fighting or something, then just yield or the give? Not because you are weak or something like that. Actually, it's an expression of victory by giving the others victory. So before we leave, let's conclude with a very short meditation. This spirit of Shantideva, see if you can immerse yourself and imagine actually this happen. May I become at all times, both now and forever, a protector for those without protection, a guide for those who have lost their way, a ship for those with oceans to cross, a bridge for those with rivers to cross, a sanctuary for those in danger, a lamp for those without light, a place of refuge for those who lack shelter, and a servant to all in need. So imagine your body is filled with this bodhicitta nectar light, like a lighthouse in a dark ocean. Then light goes out through every pore of your skin, shining, dispelling the darkness, darkness in the world, in the ocean, mountain, galaxy. See if you can imagine like that. You actually become a lighthouse for those without light, bringing warmth, happiness, joy, and comfort. Imagine light goes out as far as it reaches. Again, imagine actually it's happening. Then slowly gather back to your body, to your central channel, then rest in your heart center as a strong determination and natural human heart of bodhicitta. Then we carry this wherever we go. Whatever we do, whatever difficult situation we are facing, when we face with enemy, friends, challenges, always bodhicitta is here. Everything coming out of this, unfolding on bodhicitta. Thank you, everybody. This year, what I'm excited about, what's unfold. I'm not sure about what's unfold, but whatever unfolds, if we do from this place, then it's not gonna go wrong, no? So let's do that.